September 1970. The Buffalo Sabres are at last a reality. After many months of hard work, Punch Imlach has managed to put together a National Hockey League team. The Buffalo Sabre organization is pleased to present to you Sabres Ready, the story of the building of the NHL's newest team, the Buffalo Sabres. The executive committee of the Niagara Frontier Hockey Corporation was not long involving the future fans of the new Buffalo franchise. Under the direction of its governors, Seymour and Northrop Knox, the Niagara Frontier Hockey Corporation offered the fans an opportunity to name the newest National Hockey League team in the form of a contest. After receiving over 1,000 different names, ranging from the Zips to the Mugwumps, the committee decided on a name which would best exemplify the aggressiveness, excitement, and action of an NHL team. The Buffalo Sabres. We spoke to the Knox brothers prior to the National Hockey League draft in Montreal.
Gentlemen, we know you have a love for hockey. How far back does this game go in the Knox family?
Well, Brian, I can remember our father many, many years ago taking us down to a pond on the family place. We started playing hockey there. Must have been about the age of around 10.
Norty, I understand you were the goaltender in the family. Is that
yeah,
true?
I was a goalie up at college and also at school. And that's where I started, I guess, my real interest in hockey.
This Punch Imlach is quite a hockey man. I know that a lot of people are delighted to see him in the game again with your club.
Well, I'm sure that Punch is glad to be back in the National Hockey League. I know that he was our first choice right from the very start. He's the most proven product in the game, and we were just delighted to have him and very fortunate to have him with us.
He'll sell a lot of tickets for you, too.
Oh, yes, he's a very colorful guy. He'll do a good job of that.
You know, it's a tough chore molding an NHL hockey club from the ground up. What about the headaches? Do you look back now, you're deeply involved with hockey. Do you ever look back and say, why in the world did we ever get involved in this business?
Well, I tell you, there were a lot of problems, let's face it. But now we have the privilege of being in the league, and we have other kinds of problems, and we don't mind solving those. We've met each one as they've come by, and we've seemed to have gotten through most of them.
Any comments, Norty?
That's the price you have to pay, and we are devoted to the game of hockey, and we're going to do the very best we can to produce the best team that we can field, and we're looking forward someday to getting in the Stanley Cups, and that's our ambition, and that's what we're going to do.
Well, I know among the owners you're a welcome addition to the Lodge, and congratulations to you. Good luck with the Sabres.
Thanks very much.
The order of play will be in the expansion.
June 1970, the NHL Players Draft in Montreal. This is where the Sabres would acquire the players who would wear their colors through the growing pains considered unavoidable in the first couple of seasons. The first spin would determine whether Buffalo or Vancouver would get first choice in the expansion draft.
Remember, it's Buffalo high, Vancouver low. Number is 8.
Buffalo had won first choice of the players in the expansion draft. Then came the all-important second spin.
Number
1, Vancouver the winner. But wait, it's 2-1s, 11. The Sabres had also landed first choice in the amateur draft.
Punch, I've always known you were a lucky man, but Lady Luck was right in your hip pocket today.
Well, I've always said it's better to be lucky than good, and I'm quite happy with the way things went this afternoon.
Well, tell us how you felt when that roulette wheel was spinning down there.
Well, actually, naturally, it's quite... you wonder what's going to happen. Of course, we won the first one, and we'd won the toss before, and said, well, it's not... the odds are starting to go against you. And, of course, I think when they call out the number... I wasn't looking at it. I was looking down at the paper trying to do something, and they said number 1. Well, I said, well, that's it. But then it came back, it was 2-1s, and it was number 11, and we won, and I think the heart just turned right over, started to pound pretty good, because it's very important that that was the one to really win.
Number 11, of course, is the number that Jill Perreault wears. Now, can we assume from this that you're going to draft Jill Perreault number one tomorrow?
I would assume that you could say that I'm going to take Jill Perreault tomorrow.
Who would you rate him with as a junior? Beliveau?
Well, because he's French-Canadian, Perreault, Beliveau, I don't think that's really fair because Beliveau's been in the league. He set all the records, and why would you try to saddle a kid with that kind of a... I'll be just happy if Perreault can play up to the expectations that everybody thinks he can.
The evening hours after the draft meeting were spent going over the lengthy lists of available players. The Buffalo executive present included Imlach, his assistant general manager Fred Hunt, chief scout John Anderson, and Al Miller. While Punch and his staff worked out the final details on their draft selections, we spoke to Mr. Seymour Knox.
Mr. Knox, I know you were aware you were getting an intelligent hockey man in Punch Imlach. Were you aware you were also getting a very lucky one?
Well, Brian, I'm very glad we did get a lucky one. I didn't know he was going to be as lucky, of course, as he was today, but we were hoping for a chance to get an opportunity to pick first choice in each of those drafts, and by gosh, it worked out that way.
What was your emotional reaction?
Well, of course, I'm very, very happy. I think it's going to be a big thing for our franchise in Buffalo, and I'm sure that we're going to have a great hockey player in the person of Gilles Perreault if we exercise that choice on Thursday, which I'm certain we will.
In the expansion draft, Buffalo and Vancouver were to select 18 players each. Imlach's first choice raised no eyebrows.
Tom Webster, Boston. Tom Webster from Boston. Vancouver.
So Tom Webster became the first player to be selected by one of the new expansion clubs.
Sorry, Buffalo. From New York, Alan Hamilton. From New York, Alan Hamilton.
Imlach's other choices were applauded by the hockey men in attendance.
New York, Phil.
Stafford, could we get a comment from you on the future of the Buffalo Hockey Club and your old pal Punch Imlach?
Well, I can give you a very definite comment because I had a big meeting with our staff 2 days ago. They're so interested in beating Punch Imlach, they forgot the fact that they're trying to win the Stanley Cup. And I told them, forget it and win the Stanley Cup. But I can't get them to forget it because all they want to do is beat Punch Imlach.
Well, how do you think Punch is going to do with the Sabres now in the first year of operation?
Well, Punch is lucky. He's got that going for him. Punch is a good hockey man. And starting from scratch, he'll do very, very well.
And do you feel that there's going to be a tremendous inter-city rivalry build up between Toronto and Buffalo?
No, I don't feel that because I think we'll win every game and there won't be any rivalry.
Okay, thanks very much.
Buffalo, from New York. Marshall. From New York. Marshall.
The expansion draft was nearing completion. When suddenly Sid Abel, the general manager of the Detroit Red Wings, stood up and made an announcement.
Detroit Hockey Club would like to make an announcement of a trade with Buffalo, Detroit Braves, goaltender Roger Crozier, Tom Webster,
Punch had begun dealing to build the Sabre team. A man in a similar situation is Bud Poile, general manager of the Vancouver Canucks, the NHL's other new entry.
But it may be premature to ask this, but how do you think you're going to fare in this first year of NHL expansion for Vancouver?
Well, you know, we're in pretty fast company with Montreal and Boston, etc. But I think that Vancouver and Buffalo drafted fairly well, and with the West Division, I think we can hold our own there. Minnesota looked like they've improved, but. I think we're just as good as any other club in that Western Division.
And how do you feel that Buffalo will make out?
Well, with Punch, he wins all the tosses. He usually comes up with the winners. He'll do all right. I'm not worrying about him. I'm worrying about Bud Poile.
Okay, thank you very much.
Punch Imlach fared quite well in the previous day's draft, picking up such noted players as Phil Goyette, Don Marshall, Reg Fleming, and in one of his patented moves, Roger Crozier. Imlach has always maintained that no major league team can survive without both a first-rate goaltender and NHL-experienced playmakers. Today was not to be any exception. Buffalo, thanks to Punch Imlach and his lucky suit, had first choice from all the top amateur players in North America.
Buffalo, number 14.
Gilbert Carroll.
Last year in junior hockey, Perreault led the junior Canadiens to the Memorial Cup as he scored 51 goals and collected 70 assists. It wasn't long before the other junior stars were swallowed up by the remaining clubs, but Punch was certain he had grabbed the best in Perreault.
Dead Marsh from Brandon. Dead, D-A-D, Marsh, M-A-R-S-H.
From Peter Peace, Junior A Hockey Club, Ronald Schwab.
Buffalo, number 14.
Y. Rosa from Edmonton. Randy. W, Y, R, O, Z, U, B. Z, I mean Z.
Can you do that again?
No.
Well, Punch, how about a comment on your selections in the amateur draft today?
Well, I think that we did pretty well. We got the first choice, and we got a real top-notch hockey player, I suppose the best hockey player in Canada. And the next two choices, I think, will probably make a good run at making the team. One's a tough defenseman, played in Toronto with the Maulvers, and the other one was a kid from the Oak West, and he's what, his name is Dead Marsh, and he's first name is Butch, so we're looking for a tough kid and can skate well. So I think we've done very well, and from now on, we've got to put it all together now. We've got to start sorting it out and try and put it on paper, what kind of a team we have, and then we'll have to fill in any holes.
How do the rest of the fellas, the scouts, feel about today's events?
Well, not only about today's events, but they've done a terrific job. It's one of the things that certainly I have, I think, the best people working for me. We're set up with our organization as good as any in the National Hockey League, and they're to be commended and thanked for the way they did their homework, because they didn't get anything by them at all.
And you took time out to say hello to Gilles Perreault once you drafted him today.
Oh, yes. Of course, everybody wanted the pictures and everything else. And geez, a good-looking kid. All the girls in Buffalo are going to be chasing him, I'll tell you.
So now you got the players' next stop training camp.
That's right. Away we go.
While Punch acquired the players, Sabres Vice President Dave Foreman was busy supervising the refurbishing of the auditorium.
Mr. Foreman, could you describe some of the difficulties in refurbishing the auditorium?
Brian, as you know, we really didn't get started on this job, or the city of Buffalo didn't, until around the 1st of July. And to try and do what's being done here in that period of time really creates a lot of problems. But as you can see from looking around here, they're doing a lot of work. When this is done this year, we expect to have the new gold seats in, which are on the ice level. We will have about 10,300 seats available for this year. And then next year, we will raise the roof and put in the balcony and have about 15,500 seats.
I understand the Sabres will be offering some very unique concession stands.
Well, that's right. Our corporation is not only the hockey team, but we have the concession rights for the auditorium and other things down here. And one of the things that we are going to make sure of is that this is big league. And in order to be big league, it has to be big league all the way. And that includes concessions and parking and stadium clubs for the season ticket holders and everything else that goes with it.
And you have a new clock going in, too?
Yes, we do. This clock that you see out here has been in here for a number of years, and that I hope will be thrown in the junk pile, and a new clock will arrive here the last week in September and are going to be installed in here and will be operating this year.
And I understand there was a delay in the construction here due to a legal problem.
There isn't much point in going into that. I'll just tell you that it's a battle all the way, and we're playing here on the 15th, and I can assure you that.
In the past 4 years, Mr. Clarence Campbell, president of the NHL, has seen 8 new clubs enter the National Hockey League. Mr. Campbell, are you impressed with the manner in which the Knox brothers of Buffalo have taken on this challenge of forming a big league hockey organization?
Well, I'm tremendously impressed not only by the method and the manner in which they've conducted themselves, but their amazing tenacity. They were interested in coming into the National Hockey League even before we announced the first expansion, and they pursued that as vigorously as they could. When they were not successful in getting a franchise in the 1967 expansion, they never lost interest. They went on and tried to acquire the franchise in Oakland and were only partially successful. But later on, of course, they got the opportunity to be the second club, or be one of two clubs in the new expansion for 1970-71. And I think their conduct has been impeccable, absolutely wonderful.
Thank you very much, sir.
It's been a pleasure.
Training camp, Peterborough, Ontario. For years, the Toronto Maple Leafs used Peterborough as their hockey headquarters. Now the Leafs are gone and the Buffalo Sabres have taken over. Imlach is superstitious. 4 times the team he trained at Peterborough went on to win the Stanley Cup. Trainers Frank Christie, formerly of the Buffalo Bisons, and Don Wren, whom the Sabres acquired from the Chicago Blackhawks, have set up the complete camp and are prepared for the onslaught of hopeful players. The players check in, and the first few days are hectic. The club doctors check each player over carefully before equipment is issued. This training camp is very unique, unlike others that will follow in the years to come.
Bend the leg, back straight, just to put your leg muscle.
It was soon very plain to all of the players that the camp was not to be any holiday. Imlach arranged for the services of an Armed Forces physical education instructor to be on hand to get the players in shape for the tough season ahead. As training camp progressed, we had an opportunity to talk with several of the future Sabres.
Reg, a new city, a new uniform. How do you think you're going to enjoy Buffalo?
Well, I'm playing for a new man also, Punch Imlach, and we just hope we have the same success that he had in Toronto. And I think I'm going to enjoy it very much.
You've always been, shall we say, a little bit pugnacious on the ice. Are you going to continue to be the rough, tough customer with the Sabres?
Well, Brian, it's kept me in the league for 10 years, hasn't it? And I hope it keeps me here for another 10. I'll play it by ear.
You won't step aside from anybody.
No, I don't think I should.
Good luck to you, Red.
Thank you very much, Brian.
Once on the ice, they view each other with a critical eye, wondering how stiff the competition will be for each position and how many of them will survive the final cut.
Well, here's Floyd Smith, a right winger, a veteran of NHL play and a new member of the Buffalo Sabres. Floyd, are you looking forward to playing in Buffalo?
Yes, I am, Brian, very much.
What do you think about the change that brought you now? You were with the Toronto Maple Leafs, and then suddenly over the summer, you're with the Sabres.
Well, as far as Toronto's concerned, I was very happy there. I had no plans of playing there. I didn't get along too well with the management, and I was just very happy that Mr. Imlach brought me to Buffalo.
Well, you played with Punch before.
Yes, I have, on two different occasions.
So you're delighted to have such a man in charge.
You better believe it.
And how about this situation, Floyd? Going back into Toronto, let's say, for the first game, it'd be kind of nice to score the winning goal, don't you think?
Something to look forward to anyways, isn't it?
Good luck to you.
Thank you, Brian.
Imlach puts them right to work. A couple of skating sessions and they're ready to start scrimmages. This is where the player's ability, or lack of, is soon spotted. Imlach and his assistants make comparisons, quickly noting the difference between those with prior NHL experience and the hopeful rookies. While Punch ran his players through their first scrimmages, we traveled to Buffalo and asked the Sabres fans this question.
What do you think of the new Buffalo entry in the National Hockey League, the Buffalo Sabres?
I think it's a fantastic idea because Buffalo has needed this for a long time.
I think it's great for the town.
Fine. I think it's a big boost for Buffalo, and we need more sports, more activity in the city.
Well, it's just good for Buffalo.
I think it's pretty good because it's what Buffalo needs, the National Hockey League. It boosts up Buffalo a lot.
How do you think the Sabres will make out? How do you think they'll make out?
I think they'll do pretty good.
I think from what the material they have, from what I've been reading, that they'll probably do as well as any other expansion team in the league.
Well, they're not going to have a greater win record than loss record, so they're going to surprise an awful lot of people.
Tell me, what do you think of Punch Imlach?
Well, I didn't like him when he was at Toronto, but I think he'll be all right here.
I think he'll do a good job. He's a good coach.
September the 17th, 1970. Buffalo Sabres versus the New York Rangers. After a long, hard training camp, the players are now ready for their first game as a Buffalo Sabre. The Peterborough fans, most of them curious to see what kind of team Buffalo's $6 million has bought them, turn out anticipating a rout of the Sabres. The New York Rangers, with stars like Eddie Jackham and Rod Gilbert, come to play the fledgling Sabres. The Sabres are out to prove them wrong. Only minutes into the game, Billy Inglis scores Buffalo's first goal ever, and the Sabres lead 1-0. Again, before the end of the period, Buffalo presses long and deep into the New York end, and Perreault passes to Legacy. He shoots and scores, and the Sabres lead 2-0. Midway into the second period, the Sabres strike again. This time, Legacy connects from Meehan, and the Buffalo team has a 3-0 lead. The fans can hardly believe their eyes. Reg Fleming picks up a loose puck and fires it home. Buffalo 4, New York nothing. In the third period, the experience of the New York Rangers came through, and led by their captain Bob Nevin, started to narrow the margin. Dave Dryden was superb in the Buffalo net, but the rest of the Sabres could not maintain their fast pace, and soon the Rangers were the superior force and the score dwindled to 4-3.
1 minute of play remaining.
With less than a minute left in the game, New York tried to pull their goalie, and as the Rangers rush up the ice, Gilles Villemure skates off in favor of an extra attacker, Rod Gilbert. Gilbert picks up the pass, cuts in on Dryden, shoots the rebound, he scores! Only 29 seconds left, and the Rangers tie the game. After the game, he chatted with Punch.
Punch, for a while tonight, it looked as if the Buffalo Sabres were going to pick up their first victory in National Hockey League competition.
Well, they started scoring goals on us pretty easily. It didn't take them long. I think it was 2 minutes they had a goal, and of course this doesn't help you. You get by those first shifts in the third period, you start to go downhill, but when they get one, then they get two, and then you start to tighten up a little. I think this is what happened with us, and of course we're a new team, and you tend to tighten up a little bit more, and this caused you a lot of trouble.
During training camp, the coach has to do a lot of shuffling with his lines. But not having coached all these players before, did you find it difficult to set up specific line combinations?
Well, this is difficult. And then we got injuries right off the bat, which made the lines, shook up the lines. And, of course, the names of the players, too, are different. It's not like it was before, where you live with people for 9 or 10 years and you know them in your sleep, you might say. So sometimes it's a little more difficult, but it's going to get easier as time goes on.
Although the Rangers came from behind and tied the score, what is your impression of the Sabres' overall play
Well, I was quite happy, naturally, to be ahead 4-0. I'm bitterly disappointed that we didn't, win it. It would have been nice to start out the Buffalo Sabres with a win in the first exhibition game. But I'd rather have a win, let's say, in the first league game. That would be an awful lot better.
The Buffalo Sabres continued their tough training schedule, and on October the 10th, 1970, Punch got his wish, as the Sabres did win their first NHL league game, defeating the Pittsburgh Penguins by a score of 2-1. At the arena, the seats are freshly painted, the ice is installed, and the refurbished areas are completed. The auditorium is ready. So is the team. The lines and defense combinations are set. Punch Imlach is ready for his return to the National Hockey League. His team may not be honed like the true Sabres edge, but before long, if Imlach has his way, the Sabres will cut a swath through the National Hockey League. Welcome, Sabres, to the world's fastest game. The blue, white, and gold of the new Buffalo Sabres. That first year is already history, and the Sabres have established themselves as one of the NHL's robust adolescents, full of spunk, ability, and ambition, with dead aim set on the Stanley Cup. Peace Bridge Authority invites you to relive that historic first year as we present Touché.
Pardon the hat, but I didn't think you hockey fans would recognize me any other way. I'm Punch Imlach, and I'm proud to introduce to the greatest hockey fans in the world this fellow, my Buffalo Sabres, and their first year of National Hockey League action. The Peace Bridge, the main entrance to the USA, is happy to bring you this unique action film. And when I say main entrance, you can take my word for it. For no one in the province of Ontario has had occasion to use the Peace Bridge more than I. Commuting from Toronto this past season made me believe that the Peace Bridge is the main entrance and a way to go when you're bound for Buffalo. Well, enjoy the film, brought to you as a public service by your friends at the Peace Bridge.
The Niagara Frontier Hockey Corporation, headed by Seymour and Northrop Knox, succeeded in bringing the National Hockey League to Buffalo in January 1970 after years of effort. 10 months and thousands of hours of hard work later, the Buffalo Sabres had their NHL debut in Pittsburgh. The Penguins, who had rushed to with an easy win over the Sabres, but the tenacious checking of the young Buffalo team, combined with the first and career goal for defenseman Jim Watson, the first in league history for Buffalo, gave the Sabres a lead. Then rookie Gilles Perreault scored the winner to complete night of firsts, earning first win and first goal by the talented young center. After a heroic stand by Roger Crozier and goal during a 3-0 loss to the New York Rangers, the Sabres National Hockey League president Clarence Campbell, Sabres president Seymour Knox, Canadiens president David Molson, and Buffalo Mayor Sedita were among the dignitaries present for the opening ceremonies at Center Ice. Canadiens great captain John Beliveau and Sabres captain Floyd Smith went for the official draw. Then came the game. The Sabres, eager to win in their first home game, were no match for Beliveau, J.C. Tremblay, Richard and company. Roger Crozier, easily the most outstanding Sabre in the first third of the season, made saves which ranged from the miraculous to the routinely sensational, as he kept the Sabres in the game through the early going, despite a bombardment of over 20 shots a period. It was the first on-ice meeting of Perreault and Béliveau, his schoolboy idol. The Canadiens' vast experience, coupled with solid defensive play and goalie Phil Mir's quick glove hand, kept Buffalo off the score sheet. Watch veterans Richard, Béliveau, and Cornoyer headman the puck on this play for the final Montreal goal. Phil Mir's shutout was a disappointment for the Sabres and their fans. That home opener was an omen of some hard times ahead, as injuries, temporary retirements, and inexperience resulted in the Sabres resting in the East Division cellar through the first few weeks of the schedule. Then Punch Imlach's persuasive powers paid off. First, he traded for rookie winger Steve Atkinson from St. Louis. Shortly afterwards, defenseman Jean-Guy Talbot and winger Larry Keenan came from the Blues in another Imlach deal. By November, he had talked 1970 Lady Byng Trophy winner Phil Goyette and veteran Donnie Marshall out of retirement. And when Punch returned to Toronto, his newly acquired veterans were ready to play. And the fans were ready for Punch in Toronto, Recording him a standing ovation on his first appearance behind a Maple Leaf Gardens visitor's bench. Leaf boss Stafford Smythe had been asked earlier if the Buffalo-Toronto rivalry would be intense.
No, I don't feel that because I think we'll win every game and there won't be any rivalry.
The Leafs jumped in front in a goal by Gary Monahan. But a Sabres power play put Marshall and Goyette on the ice for the first time in the regular season, and Marshall backhanded the tying goal at 9:15 of the first period. The Sabres continued their reply to Mr. Smythe with two goals and two assists by Toronto native Jerry Meehan. Linemates, ex-Leafs Keenan and Floyd Smith, accounted for the winning and insurance goals, aided by the rookies' playmaking. Crozier was spectacular. Watch Leafs Mike Walton, number 16, slam his stick in frustration as Roger robs the Leafs with another incredible save. Atkinson scored as Buffalo poured it on and went up 6-2. Toronto changed goalies, bringing in rookie Murray McLaughlin, but the Sabres weren't slowed down one bit. Meehan sets up Paul Andrea for the seventh and final goal. The Sabres, burdened by a schedule that at one point called for 14 out of 16 games against the old established NHL clubs, still struggled at the bottom of the East Division. Dealing from strength is easy. Dealing from weakness, more difficult. Yet, Imlach obtained the ebullient Eddie Shack and the steady veteran Dick Duff from the Los Angeles Kings. And while the wins weren't piling up, the Sabres were playing better hockey. Then the schedule turned around. The Philadelphia Flyers visited Buffalo and were greeted by a Floyd Smith goal and a heavy shot bombardment leading to a 3-2 Buffalo win. As the season progressed, so did Buffalo. At one point, the Sabres had gone 10 home games with only one loss. Soon, Buffalo edged past both Detroit and Vancouver in the East Division standings. One of the reasons was the steady improvement of goalie Joe Daly, one of the two goaltenders in the league who doesn't wear a mask. Daly was spectacular and earned himself a permanent NHL job with these kinds of saves. Eddie Shack was not long becoming a fan's favorite with his pell-mell rink-length rushes. Bill Goyette and Donnie Marshall scored at their usual career rates. And Punch was pleased with the play of Meehan and some of the other previously underrated players such as Paul Andrea, Ron Anderson, Skip Brake, Jim Watson, and Doug Berry, the last, a defenseman whose size belies the fact that he gives no quarter. Joe Perreault, Imlach's number one choice in the amateur draft last year, was named to the East Division All-Star team and was a three-star selection in the midseason classic. After the All-Star game, Perreault shifted gears from fast to faster and began closing in on the rookie goal scoring and total points records. His puck handling and playmaking, coupled with the team's most accurate shot, moved him among the league's leading scorers. Perreault, the superstar to be, butted into what one rival club official described as the superstar that is. The 20-year-old French Canadian's moves and speed drove opposition coaches to superlatives and opposition players to frustration. Sometimes the only way to stop Perreault was to put him in the net and keep him there. Philadelphia's Doug Favell tried that technique, and watch the look Jill gives him. Buffalo fans flocked to a rejuvenated Memorial Auditorium in record numbers. Not only did they fill the rink for every game as the season progressed, but proved to be some of the most vocal and enthusiastic fans in the National Hockey League. It isn't all excitement and glamour of game time for the NHL players. The Sabres jetted coast to coast to make the demanding 78-game schedule. It takes a lot of preparation to get a team ready for a game, at home or away. On game night, this case in Detroit, trainers Frank Christie and Don Oren are hard at work readying the equipment and uniforms. Reggie Fleming tapes a stick. And Eddie Shack's wrist gets a tape job of its own. Every player dresses at his own pace, and some are superstitious, but it's all a prelude to the action. Detroit is really up for this one, but the Sabres are not to be had easily. Gary Meehan was the game's individual star. Here he's robbed by the goalie's best friend, Mr. Goalpost. Then former Red Wing Roger Crozier hovers up at the Buffalo end, and Meehan comes back to score his first goal. Watch this great second effort. Later on, Dick Duff steals the puck from Gordie Howe and sends away Meehan for a hard blue line slap shot. Goal number two for Jerry. In the second period, Crozier even gets into the body checking business, jousting with Red Wing Pete Stemkowski in the goal crease. Continued end-to-end with Reggie Fleming missing a golden opportunity and Dick Duff failing just seconds later. But Meehan didn't fail on this effort. Watch him score his third goal again in a great second effort. It was the fast-developing center's first NHL hat trick, a payoff for his six shots on goal. The Sabres had a 5-4 lead with only 5 minutes in the game. Gordie Howe leads the Wings and ties the score with just over 4 minutes remaining. Again, the experience of Gordie Howe and the Red Wings pays off as Red Berenson slams home the winning goal past a dejected Roger Crozier. A hard game to lose, but a great performance by a steadily improving Sabres club. After it was all over, tired muscles, bruises, and all, the Sabres are off to the airport for the trip home. On the plane, the players pass the time playing bridge, reading, or reviewing the night's action. Back at home, the fans were treated to exciting hockey as the Sabres played the Stanley Cup champions, the Boston Bruins. Superstar Bobby Orr, the Bruins had come back to Buffalo determined to crush this young Sabre team that had given them such a difficult time throughout the season. The Stanley Cup winners did prove to be too much for the Buffalo team this time as they defeated the Sabres by a score of 6-3. But not before Gilles Perreault had scored his 30th NHL goal to the delight of the Buffalo fans. Let's look at that again in slow motion. Watch the high backswing on his hard slap shot after Tracy Pratt and Floyd Smith send him up the wing with passes. It was a wide-open affair, with both clubs trading spectacular rushes. Tempers flared and Doug Barry versus John McKenzie nearly switched from words to fists. Another bright spot for the Buffalo supporters was Tracy Pratt's first goal ever as a Buffalo Sabre. Later in the season, the Sabres would foil the Bruins' try at a consecutive win record in Boston with a 7-5 upset. The Sabres continued their determined style of play, and as the season entered its final month, they were really starting to click. On March the 5th, Buffalo met the rough, tough Chicago Blackhawks with such superstars as Bobby Hull, Stan Mikita, and Tony Esposito. The Sabres had not managed to record a win in any of their previous meetings with the Blackhawks. The Buffalo team knew they had improved and were out to show it to the West Division leaders. The Sabre defensive units were up for this game and repeatedly stopped Bobby Hull in the potent Chicago attack. Joe Daly keeps one out in a sprawling stop off Jim Pappin. And Perreault sends Eddie Shack up on the left wing. Eddie fires a hard wrist shot to put the Sabres back in the game. Moments later, Hawks defenseman Keith Magnusson is caught up ice, and Meehan feeds Atkinson at the goal mouth to tie it up. Bobby Hull nearly unties it with this breakaway, but Daly covers up sensationally. Esposito matches Joe at the Chicago end. Daly plays one upmanship with another fine save as both goalies are called on to make a series of game-saving stops. Jim Watson is penalized in the last minute and doesn't like the call, but the Sabres hold on for the tie to the fans' delight. It gives Buffalo at least 1 point off every club in the National Hockey League, an exceptional feat for a first-year team. Led by the Sabres captain Floyd Smith, the Buffalo penalty-killing unit stifled many power play attempts by opposing clubs. Diligent checking by Skip Crane, former badman Reg Fleming, and Kevin O'Shea kept opponents frustrated repeatedly. Even though they could not make the Eastern Division playoffs, the Buffalo Sabres were not finished yet. They still had several exciting moments for the fans and several frustrating games left for their opponents. Gilles Perreault was rapidly closing in on the rookie scoring records as he tallied his 33rd and 34th goals against the Vancouver Canucks in Buffalo. Shortly afterward, in Minnesota, Gilles tried for the record-breaking goal. Even though Gilles did not score in this game, the rest of the Sabres were having a field day as Kevin O'Shea scored his first National Hockey League goal. Dave Dryden, recalled when Roger Crozier was injured, plays superbly in recording a shutout win. After losing his catching glove, watch Dryden make a move to catch the puck barehanded as it shot across the goal mouth. The Sabres returned to Buffalo a determined team, determined to win against St. Louis, and determined to help Gilles Perreault get that elusive number 35. The fired-up Sabres were not long in taking the lead on goals by Marshall, Shack, and Fleming. snow was everywhere, but it looked as if his 35th would elude him again that night.
He still has it. He's got the puck. Rather, that bears it on the left point. Jack tries to keep it in. He does. Into the corner to Marshall. Goes to Perreault. The drive from the short side. And it was deflected into the corner. Trying to look for Marshall. Oh, backhand drive. Perreault's right there. He shoots. He scores.
Let's look at the record breaker again in slow motion. Watch Hamilton knock down the puck in a flash and Gill lift it past the St. Louis goaltender. Perreault had set a new National Hockey League record. The crowd was ecstatic and Gill was accorded two lengthy standing ovations. The Buffalo fans not only had an exciting hockey club, but also an NHL record holder in this, their first year. On March the 26th, the Vancouver Canucks, the NHL's other new expansion club, came into Buffalo, and the fans turned out in full force to see how the two new teams compared at the end of the first season. Vancouver drew first blood as Corrigan scored his 20th goal of the season and the Canucks led 1-0. Between periods, Punch Imlach fired up the Sabres with one of his patented dressing room talks. When the Buffalo team returned to the ice, the Canucks were unable to maintain the Sabres' accelerated pace and Buffalo was soon in command. With goals by Goyette and Meehan, the Sabres took a 2-1 lead. The Vancouver-Buffalo rivalry is already intense, and both teams, including a swinging Joe Daly, mixed it up in the third period. The 20th marker. Sabres went on to tie this, their last home game of the 1970-71 season, and the fans expressed their appreciation with a standing ovation for the whole team as the final buzzer sounded. Punch, the first season is now on record. The Sabres finished higher than I think that a lot of people expected.
Well, a lot of people I would go along with, but not higher than some people expected. Of course, you know how I feel about it. I'd like to have been in the playoffs, I guess we have to be thankful for small mercies. The team played very well. Everybody, I think, played just about as good as they could, and after all, that's all that counts.
Well, Punch, the Sabres finished in fifth place this year in the Eastern Division. Do you have any predictions for next season?
Well, we're playing since Christmas 500%. That means that over that long period of time, it wasn't just a mistake, it's a fact. And what we have to do is try and make it better next year, play maybe 60 or 65%. And according to do that, we're going to have to get a couple of more hockey players better than what we have, or we hope that we can get them better than what we have. And if we can improve just that small 10, 15%, we'll be in the playoffs next year.
Some reflections from Sabres President Seymour Knox III.
I've been very proud of our Buffalo Sabres in this, our very first season of the National Hockey League this year. Been simply delighted the way they've played on the ice, and even more excited about the way the fans on the Niagara Frontier have responded to our team. I'm sure that Punch Imlach will have even better teams for us here in the future, and I'm sure also that it won't be too long before we'll be in the Stanley Cup. So thank you very much for your support, and I hope that you fans will be coming back to Memorial Auditorium, and we'll see even better hockey from here on in the future.
The Sabres shocked the National Hockey League in their first season, finishing ninth in overall point standings among 14 teams, the best team in the league outside the playoffs. Next stop is a playoff berth and a shot at the Stanley Cup. A shocking proposal for a second-year club, no more than predicting the Sabres would finish as high as they did in their inaugural year. The year the Sabres developed the winning touch.
Not bad for the first year. We made our presence known, and this coming season you'll hear a lot more from our youngsters and the old steady hands that will be back with the Sabres. Come on over and see us. It's been a pleasure for the Peach Bridge to bring you this film. And don't forget, when you head for Saberland, Buffalo, and point south and east, take the Peace Bridge, the main entrance to the USA and